So thank you so much for the kind introductions. They're still longer than we wanted. Next time we'll restrict it to first name. Let everybody figure us out. Make a game. You know, thanks guys for kind of joining in. We unfortunately could not get Nitesh on the panel. He fell ill this morning. So you know, which it would be nice to have Nazara on. You're going to jump straight into certain questions that, you know, we thought were relevant. If any of you guys feel that there's something that we're going off track, or you know, you want something else, throw something at us. You know, preferably softer bottles, and we'll remember, we'll learn. You know, credit the reason I'm here is because Rahul Khanna from X Clear Stone funded me. So, Mr. Khanna, thank you very much for putting me on the panel. You know, always credit your VC when it's due. First good step at a VC circle conference. Kya pata aur capital mil jaye, right? So guys, you know, the most dramatic, I think the most dramatic, you know, kind of development that has happened in the mobile gaming business in the last 3 months has been Candy Crush. How many of you guys are crushing candy every day? So unfortunately, we don't seem to be in, I think we're in the wrong conference here. But anyway, let's say, you know, please go out there and eat some candy and crush, you know, been in the valley, which is my concern. This is why I'm kind of bringing back that topic. But I think they'll be closing at least $50 to $60 million top line. And let me tell you guys that, you know, unlike the businesses that y'all may be involved in, or hopefully you are involved in, these businesses are minimum net 60% to 70% margin businesses, minimum. So if you're doing $100 million top line, you're minimum doing $70 million PAT. There is no T or whatever the hell that is, but it's like 70% net.
So I think there will be this marriage of also, you know, East and West. You know, I think you're doing it. You set up a studio in
San Fran, yeah.
We did that when we were at Jump, and, you know, I think they've done some more recently. Because you will need, you know, people from there also.
Very good point.
Because, you know, they've spent 30 years in gaming, you know. You're right, 30 years from now we'll do it.
30 years from now, right. So Siddharth, what do you say? You said Europe was what's the point of Europe and this?
Basically, I'll just try and sort of mix the answer with who we are right now and why I think sort of my answer would be Candy Crush.
It's not a
should
pitch,
happen.
Right? It's not a company pitch, right?
It's not a company.
That's not allowed.
It's like, it's like saying that sort of in a year we've been able to see out of India a lot of users globally.
Yes.
Right? And it's not just the Indian market. I mean, 95% of our downloads and traffic is coming from outside. We're doing sort of so many impressions and so much scale that we are able to sort of work with multiple ad networks to actually monetize by ad networks too.
Awesome.
And see the sort of percentages that you're saying are there. And in sort of, I wouldn't be here if I didn't believe that sort of we could create something like that. So I would like to be very confident and say we'll figure it out, and sort of both for talent and stuff. I mean, we are trying to figure out designers and people who can actually help us leverage and create those products.
That's a great question. Yeah, that's a good point. And I think this whole, you know, someone pointed out to a POU game on Android yesterday from Lebanon. Hmm. You know, 50 million downloads, one man shop, Minesweeper. So I think the other challenge is that creativity is becoming universal. And to make an app, you know, I'm unfortunately very old, so I keep looking at the classics. And, you know, in the very old days, there was something called the Renaissance. And there were painters and people funded them. And, you know, this is a Renaissance again. There are artists coming alive on a digital platform. And, you know, the app stores are their new dukes and barons, right? But you're right. I mean, anything can happen.
And in gaming, basically, it's very exciting because there's this whole creative side.
Yeah.
There are big numbers on the business side to aspire for. There are a huge number of users. And I mean, I come from an engineering background. There's so much analytics and things and cutting edge technology that's sort of just evolving. It's like you're always on the bleeding edge. It's not anything else. That's why it's really fun. And I would like to sort of think of myself as one of the teams that's sort of working towards making sure that
one of those things
comes out like that.
So Virat, any parting shots?
So I think my call is that as we see the company like King.com or we see Rovio making Angry Bird, we have to see the history, how these companies have evolved. Everyone has released 30, 40 games. They have internal tools, technology. And then there is a layer of creativity which transforms this tools and technology to a products which actually consumer adopts. And there's a lot of hits and misses of all these big companies. So I'm not looking for one Lebanon company to have one, five people. Because this, and I don't think any VC will invest in one guy, who, and any VC is competent enough to identify also that before releasing an app, this app will become this.
And they don't need a VC, because they're doing $100 million and $70 million. But they'll become a VC, right?
Yeah, they'll become a VC. Yeah. So the tough part is, you have to create an engine, a company, which can actually continuously test more new ideas. And to reduce the cost of testing your ideas, you have to build technology within your organization, which reduces your cost of building those games and apps.
Very, very good point.
So we guys are doing is, we guys are basically more focusing on building our first own tools and technology, which are equivalent to Gameloft and Digital Chocolate, where we all come from. And then we'll actually hire people from Russia and people from
Ukraine,
people from US. And we believe more Russian games are more innovative than as compared to US games. Because their way of execution is much different. Like if you take Zepto Lab games, if you take Game Inside games, and then we are bringing back them to Indore, and we
are based in Indore.
Yeah, Indore.
That's awesome.
So, there is a way to do things, but the key thing is you have to make talent and other stuff as a more like commodity, and you have to focus more on the creative aspects and then learning how to market them. Because I think the biggest weakness which India has is we have never marketed things.
So it's going to be the first time we're going to do large-scale marketing. So just a reference to exactly what you said, when Mr. Khanna funded us, we were an online games company. So we actually made 700 games so far, and we tested, figuring out which games works well. And we always focused on the US, and we hit Parking Frenzy, the T-shirt I'm wearing, number one. And I'm not. This is not a vanity boast. So I need to actually say it with a case study. We became a number one game after, that is our 34th game, after many, many games that, I'm ashamed to even call my games, but they still exist. And the unfortunate part was, we proved that we could do a number one free app and top game, but the instrumentation of the game, which you see in Candy, and you see in Rovio, and you see in Cut the Rope, to suck your money out, was missing. So it was a free game, it's freemiumly, it's loaded with some advertising and freemium product. But I think to me, the greatest challenge is not even anymore the title, because the titles come and go. We all have, Sid Godin said something very nice about the number one iTunes song. He said, every time you look, you will find a new song there. And you will, next time you look, you won't find it ever, most of the time. So the challenge really is not about even becoming as large as Candy Crush, is actually sucking the money out of the wallet. And that science is really nuclear. I mean, the whole ARPU, consumer, weak points, I mean, it's almost how vulnerable do you get and how do you, like put all your 300 million people in a desert first voluntarily and then sell them water, right? So I think that science is almost clinically psychology more than game engineering. I think you guys know that better because you've built games for Digital Chocolate which had that engineering in place, right?
We have people in a company who like come from Ubisoft, Digital Chocolate. So we had to put production processes in place. Right. We have to put technological processes. And the second most important thing is like, let's compare this industry to a filmmaking industry. So 5-7 guys collected, one becomes director, one becomes actor. They make a movie. Sometimes it becomes a super hit also. But if you compare that with studios like Yash Raj and if you Karan Johar studios, and you compare those studios with this 4-5 guys, the next time no one is sure that this four or five guys can actually even afford to make next movie.
But Virat, that's digressing from, just to take your example of the movie, just spend a couple of minutes more. When you go to see a great Matrix, I unfortunately won't give a Bollywood reference, but say Matrix or Star Wars. You go in, let's actually take Star Wars as an example, right? And we'll come to Salil there. Star Wars, you go in, pay $999 or 300 rupees, wherever you're watching it, and you're done. The beauty with the Star Wars game that Angry Birds put out is that it keeps sucking you out for 300 rupees in the next 3 months. That is the big difference between one-time produced content versus content that is like an amoeba. It just, one day you'll find your wallet is missing, and the game ate it up. So I think that's the real engineering that we need to do. Well, let me come to a more favorite topic of ours, and we agreed to this, to have that, throw a bomb in the audience. Unfortunately, Mohit Bhatnagar, I think, is left. Is he still around? No, he's not. So I'd requested him to stay because when I met him about 10 years ago in the Airtel office, you know, I told him that Airtel is nothing but a plumber. And, you know, the statement I want to make is that operators are plumbers. And, you know, do you agree or disagree and why? And, you know, to me, I say yes, they are plumbers. And, you know, well, not derogatory speaking, but the point is, you know, any network provider, whether it's your Wi-Fi guy or electricity guy or internet guy, doesn't tell you what to do with the stuff he sells you. So if he connects you to what he's selling, that's it. And the reason Mohit is very fond, very, very old memories, because we took Indian Idol when we started up as a VAS product. And, you know, the kind of heart, you know, biting discussions we had was an era that the operator owns the consumer and everything else is up to them. But again, coming back to Virat, you know, Amazon, Kindle, which is the platform, iOS, and Android, they don't tell you what to do. They don't tell you how to package it. They don't tell you what to price. You don't call them up and beg them for the deck position. You know, they won't even listen if you do. So, do you care about the operator? Honestly, yeah, boss, it doesn't matter. I mean, I'm the guy who asked the questions. Okay,
so
you can answer.
We didn't even earn a single dollar from operator till date.
Awesome.
And I don't know, the operator don't want us to make money, or we cannot go and run to their offices again and again. Right. This is the business we don't like at all.
Right.
If I have to comment about operator, like he has said about the plumber, so I'll say them, they're more like the last companies of license Raj.
Nice, okay.
Because you see the scams, you see everything. What is actually going on here? See, the bandwidth is given by the God. It's not given by these governments.
Let's stick to the topic of our discussion. Right? Yeah, Who cares about what they do?
It gives to the people.
Right.
Now the government gives to the operator. No. The operator controls the waves.
Let's talk about us.
Yeah.
Actually, Virat is going to have a lot of passion about this question. It's not.
It will come to you. It will come to you because it will actually move around the whole discussion. And then end of the day, they make it into small pieces. And end of the day, the consumer pays for it. And this is not just the one part where the consumer has a problem. There's one more part, is that import duties of the devices. Like as a gaming company, we need to have good devices with the people. I've seen the same phone in India, which is priced around 8,000 rupees. The same phone is priced in Thailand around 5,000 rupees. So there is a huge taxation differences in India. So that is also triggering a lot of problems for consumer to actually use the content. So at one level, you have access problem because again, the entry barriers are too high for the operators. And it is causing the internet data rates to be very
high. So your point is you don't care about the operator.
Yeah, I don't care. But right. what is going on?
Who cares? Who cares? Why? You don't care about them. You don't care about them. Who cares about what their problems are, right?
So I have a slightly different approach to this, right?
Yeah, I know that. You're very diplomatic, right?
No, I think you
made some millions through operators. We know that also.
when you are an operator, he's an operator.
He's Reliance. You're not allowed to talk, man.
I've been out a long time. You know, when we kind of started off, I think there was really no distribution channel. You know, there was no iOS. There was really no Android. You know, they didn't exist. The only way to get to the consumer really was through the operator, right? We always opposed the fact that they used to, you know, the margins were totally skewed. I think that was the real problem.
Yeah.
It really wasn't them being the distribution channel because the fact is that they had the largest reach.
We were the Afro-American slaves of the 21st century, right? We own you.
Which is why a lot of companies who started earlier went outside India because the revenue shares were much better. And then I think, you know, everyone jumped on the iOS and Android. And, you know, I've been a little out for some time. But I do know that the operators are shifting now because they're seeing the reality, right, everywhere. You know, I believe some have gone to 70-30 now.
There's a guy called Kumkaran also in the Ramayana, you know, who woke up too late. Yeah.
True.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, those structures are dismantling now. Thanks to, you know, Android and iOS. But the fact is, you know, I don't think gaming would have been in India where it was. So there's two sides.
That's a very good point.
It wouldn't have been where it was on mobile if it wasn't for the operator.
Nice.
At the same time.
Right. That's a very, very good, valid point. And I think the kind of push that they gave for whatever economic model, which is not really the important point, but the question is, what is gaming in the world anyway from India? At a meta level, okay, great. So they made a $30 million industry happen, but who cares in a $30 billion business, right? What do you say?
Basically, it's hard for me to give gyan on the overall thing, but sort of a Spice Labs, we tried a lot in India with Airtel, ASL, even Reliance and Vodafone. For us, sort of the global app stores worked phenomenally well, BlackBerry, Android, and now we're sort of trying to figure out things on iOS. So the old sort of channel partnerships and those channels were harder. The things that were working more democratically, more, I would say, sort of in open systems, which aligned with our backgrounds, we were able to sort of do far better there. So that's why the app stores are far better for us than the...
Let me add some value to this, right? The reason I brought this up was a specific point I wanted to make. I think it's no longer about revenue share. It's no longer about free access. It's now value addition. You know, I was sharing outside that around the 25th of May, we all got a mail from Amazon, all of a sudden, that now every Amazon Kindle user has 500 coins given to them. Step one, Amazon took on to themselves to give away $5. So 500 coins, $5. To about six, they don't know, we don't know the exact number, but 10 million Kindle users in the US. So $50 million was given out directly by Amazon to their consumers for apps. Right? Now I'm talking about from revenue share, where the paradigm is moving. As every app developer in the world, we woke up with delight and shock. We were delighted, but we were shocked because we were not ready for coins. So we scrambled. And we opened up every app and we said, oh my God, where's the SDK documentation? Kya kare yaar, mar gaye to. Some UN, you know, the Indian typical mentality. US mein unhone bol diya hoga logon ko, they must be ready for it. That inferiority persecution complex. So anyway, then we said, look, let's figure out what happens. How does this coin thing work? We opened our own game. And lo and behold, in the place where we had 99 cents, once you call it, it opens an API. It calls an Amazon black screen. That screen had a beautiful Amazon coin signage which says, you have 500 coins and you can use 99 to buy this game or you can pay 99 cents. That to me is what operator integration is. If you want to be an operator, you're giving me money and you're making it the most easy for the developer to really engage with the user and worldwide. I mean, there isn't anybody, any report, but any app developer on Kindle had 5 to 10x revenue in those first 1 week because it was free money, $50 million away. All the children spent it up. It was like finding loose money on the street, you know. You go and buy your candy. So I think the paradigm now, Salil, now has moved completely. People, we don't want your bandwidth anymore, yeah. You know, we want help.
Help. And it's the ecosystem sort of that even on the consumer side and on the developer side, both have to be given the chance to grow.
So more relevant question, I think, you know, let me start with Siddhartha. I mean, I think we're the few exotic animals on this platform that are building mobile game companies, right? I mean, everybody out there is building e-commerce and they're trying to sell everything in the...
And we are the only ones without a VC sitting with us so on the panel.
Right. So we're beggars basically and we're the most weird guys here. So why are we weird? Why do you want to... Why does gaming become such a difficult industry in India? What are the challenges you face and, you know, why do you do what you do? More importantly, we discussed it's a great opportunity, but, you know, you banked upon some training part, you talked about what are your three main hard pain points in building a gaming company out of India? You know, three top problems.
Okay, I've been sort of into gaming in the last 3 years and I would, before I put the pain points out, I would like to say it's like, it's really fun and I mean, I don't think I would be in any other thing.
That's not what they are here to hear.
Yeah. Now, the pain points basically is first and foremost is putting out something quality. Now, it's not, we don't have any channel. We need to put out a product that has value to the customer. So sort of just creating those products and figuring out not by looking at actually just Candy Crush or Angry Birds and saying I'll make this, but figuring out what segment, what part, what area I will be able to do well. So wherever we've identified this well, we've done the right experiments, we've done well. Wherever we've not, we've sort of taken the
course. So creative inspiration is a challenge.
Creative inspiration, but we need to temper it with whatever skills and capabilities we have.
Right. I mean, we can't build a next GTA even if we want to.
Yeah, I mean, we need to define our steps towards right. that. It can't be the first step.
Sure.
We get up and do that. Second, basically, I think has been pure, let's say, just talent. So at the gaming level, I would struggle with all the things. So the creativity, the graphics and the UX, and even the engineering, because there's a lot of cutting edge stuff that just keeps happening. And you need to sort of stay ahead of that curve. The last for me is basically just how the gaming groups support each other. So it's like how we as developers think of each other, how we coordinate and how we look at...
And we are meeting for the first time, literally,
yeah.
Right? Yeah. That's as bad as it is. Right?
So we're part of that, and that, I think, is not good in India. We need to improve that.
So let me turn to the richest guy in the room, right? Yeah. Salil. So you had everything that money could buy. Well, what couldn't you buy? I'm talking about Mr. Reliance Games, right? So you know, money constraint. You had no place constraint. I mean, your office looked like, you know, swanky Manhattan,
not ours,
whatever, right? The stuff you see now. I mean, Citibank would be ashamed by your office.
So we were the ones who moved to Pune.
Doesn't matter, man.
We were the swanky ones.
So what couldn't you do even though you had everything?
I think, you know, for us the hardest part, to an extent, was the expectation also one had.
Investor expectation.
That's tough. And... you know, the other part, I think, was when we kind of started off in gaming, you know, there wasn't too much out of India.
Right.
You know, there was really India Games.
Interesting, yeah.
You know, and I think, you know, Vishal did a phenomenal job.
Phenomenal.
Of selling the same company, I think, three times.
You're not allowed to say all that, right?
But, you know, the fact is that, you know, I think the biggest thing we struggled with initially was talent.
Right.
That was the hardest.
Got it.
Sales. Marketing and sales,
right?
Ability to sell outside India,
right?
I think that was the hardest thing.
Right. Which is what I think, Virat, you mentioned lightly in that question, right? That to ability to package, sell. Would you like to add anything in terms of beyond the talent, the inspiration, the ecosystem, the fact that, you know, we're not immersed. I mean, let's be honest, right? The biggest challenge is we're not a gaming country. You know, we're a Bollywood country. We're a, you know, soap country, soap opera country, where every other country, but we don't find a gaming company. You see kids playing games now on you know, devices, but none of our relatives, I mean, how many mamajis and taujis do you know who did gaming, right? That's the problem. And in the US, you'll have many, many people who do gaming or quasi-gaming, right? Whether it's sound or engineering or, you know, web stuff. So I think, anything you have beyond?
I think I'll add your point for the Amazon. Like, Amazon gave the coins and the invention of the virtual currency. And now the virtual currencies, the app stores are taking the virtual currency rather than, like, right now we use Tapjoy as a virtual currency. And it's an effective way to give something in cents.
The question is, what is your problem in building a gaming company in India right now beyond what we discussed?
Okay, so I think the biggest problem is to identify the correct monetization model for the products.
Right, yeah. Right.
So we, like 1.5 years back when we started doing these things, so VSurf came up and VSurf says that, okay, fine, you can make money through Nokia phones. And that VSurf was the best way.
VSurf CEO and founder sitting here, right?
Yeah, Deepak is here.
Deepak, we miss you, man.
So Deepak solved one problem for India overall level at feature phone market. Now the second problem is that now we are going for Android. In Android, cost of acquisition is so high.
Got it.
If you invest that much money, you will not recover that from consumer.
Right.
So you have to come up with a new model to make money from that consumer.
So understanding monetization is a challenge. As a games company sitting in India, there's not enough knowledge that makes you really understand the tricks and the sciences to make that happen. And very, very valid. I mean, we suffered because
of
that.
There's no success cases also. So that's also a problem.
Right. We have about 15 minutes left? 10 to 12. So, I think, sorry guys, let's just break. Guys, any questions, let's break into a Q&A because we rather max out what you guys may have. Shoot, feel free to ask or... No? No questions? Nobody has a question? Great. Salil, sorry. Someone? Yes, sir, please.
Yeah, hi, I'm Gaurav. Just wanted to ask, gaming, as you said, is something which is still coming up in our country, you know, it's still not there. So while we have a big talent pool of different technologies, such as PHP and .NET and stuff like that, how much talent pool do we have right now in terms of gaming? And what do you see in the next 3 to 5 years coming up? Do we have good institutes? Where students are coming from? Do we have experienced candidates in the market that we could go for? So a company such as ours, which is a technology company, if wants to go into gaming, what kind of a possibility do we see and what kind of challenges in terms of talent pool?
That's a very good question, actually.
Thank
can
you.
Can I answer from our experience? It's really, really difficult. You know, technologies are now thankfully settling down. So, you know, using native, a few you know, whether it's Unity or Cocos or whatever, that doesn't matter. But at the meta question that you ask, is the education, training, professional ecosystem ready? It's not. And I think the problem is even aspiration. It starts from aspiration. I don't see people aspiring to be game programmers. It's almost like, sir, meko wahan naukri nahi mili, meko Infosys mein raat ko kaam nahi karna hai, toh main game banaunga aapke liye, you know. That's the problem, right? They don't have the guts to tell their father that main game banaunga. That, I think, is the biggest problem of learning to make something like this.
There have been some signs, so sort of sitting out of Noida in Spice Labs, there's someone who's packed up his shop and he just came and said that mujhe game banana actually, and he was running sort of some gaming type of outfit, and he has no experience. He's sort of just working and interning with us, and then he's trying to evolve. The people sort of who are starting gaming companies, because the revenues and top lines are hard, but the cost of getting in at sort of simpler levels has gone down. So a lot of people are coming in, and training-wise, we've trained people internally. We've never sort of...
So this is very resonant of that hippie, right? So first the hippies played games, now the hippies make games. Now God knows when the prime minister of the country will be a game guy, right? So unfortunately, when you have people like that, we all love them, but you know, when's the next, you know, whatever, topper from IIT, IIA, XXX saying, I want to be a game guy?
No, basically, sort of, even this in a meeting like this, when I'm sitting in a gaming panel, I would expect sort of a lot of people to be looking down and playing games. I mean,
right.
I
but, don't. But then why are we here? Yeah.
I don't know. So it's a conflict, right?
They're not even tweeting. That's the problem. So anyway, it doesn't matter. Salil, your challenge. His question to your didn't you guys open Reliance Institute of Gaming Technology?
No, we didn't. But you know, I think the talent pool is increasing. You know, I've kind of, you know, been looking at, there are a few forums on gaming, and I've seen sort of the membership grow quite a bit.
Yes. NASCOM earlier, also, right?
Yeah. NASCOM has, yeah. I think it's very active.
Very active. Very
and I remember when we were there, we had IGDA, and it used to be active. There was one post in 10 days or something
it's
like that.
It's 30,000, yeah. Apparently 30,000 developers on NASCOM.
So that's huge.
That's huge.
I mean, given what gaming was. So I think... you know, that perception is changing.
Nice.
Even from, you know, I've seen some good institutes. I went to DSK in Pune some time back.
Nice.
And I was actually very impressed.
Nice.
Just by sort of, you know, their whole ideas and the thought process in terms of game creation.
In IGDA is also, is it doing some, the Bangalore guy?
I think there's
IGA. IGA, right.
So, there is, there's not enough, but, you know, I think it's changing very fast, actually. So, you know, I think there's, I think one thing fundamentally, you know, if you're a technology company, don't get into gaming. You need to be a gaming company.
Right.
You need to have the DNA of a gaming company to get. You know, Infosys tried gaming, Rolta tried gaming, a lot of people tried gaming very unsuccessfully. Because, you know, very often gaming companies kind of start as gaming companies.
But Reliance tried gaming and it succeeded.
So we actually started as a gaming company though.
Pulling your leg. I can do that with old friends.
So, I think that's primarily the you know, important part.
I just want to, any more, yes sir, please. Sorry, you just asked, anybody else with a question? Yes, the guy at the back, sorry. Sorry, we're just rotating questions, we don't mind. We'll be available offline. Get you to answer this.
Hello. Yeah, this is Devendra. Just disclaimer before I ask this question. So I never played a game before and generally don't play. So question is, Alok, for you. Basically, you said like the... in like developed country, scale is also very high, as well as margin also high, like 70%. That seems an astounding number to me. At the same time, all these guys are saying that monetizing is very difficult. So now these two things look very, very at like different at very different angles. So why it is like in a developed country, A, scale is good as well as margins are good, and where, like in India, monetization is very difficult.
So, you know, honestly, I think to the four of us, there is no country anymore. The country is the Android country, and the country is the iOS country, and the country is a Kindle country. There are three countries we live in at any given time. The problem is that the citizens of those countries only consume certain games that we all try to make. Some get lucky, some don't. So there is that Hollywood, Bollywood hit and miss model there. The challenge is not even that now. The challenge is when you do get a hit, like the three or four companies that we mentioned have proven, how do you then latch on to the person or the consumer and scale that audience in terms of revenue. So it's knowledge, sir. To be honest with you, it's knowledge. I mean, these are almost the first time in the world. Farmville, for example. I mean, let's give Zynga credit. Farmville proved that money can be made on an online game. For 10 years, we all laughed and said, you can't make money on online games. Who cares whether it was on Facebook or not? It was online. And you know, they IPO'd on the basis of Farmville. So it's still a couple of billion dollar company. I think it's knowledge, and to answer your question even more personally, I think it's the lack of imagination in a financial, you know, in just imagining what people should pay for. Let me give you almost like an Indian problem. We are attuned to saying, yaar, uske liye main paisa nahi dunga. And there they say, iske liye wo paisa dega. It starts by saying, he will pay me for tires of a car. And here I say, he won't even pay me for the car. So the orientation in the West is, let them charge them for even the air in the tire of the car that is on virtual game. And I'm saying, give the car away for free. So I think we have to live by the fact that you will pay versus you won't pay. And it's like the guys in Indigo Airlines, right? They'll ask for the air hostess 3 times for water, but they won't buy the air bottle. So you see that all the time, you say the guy won't pay money. Sorry, it's just a very personal confession. You know, I just have this attunement that we won't pay, right? But people do pay.
People do pay, and in certain categories of games in India, sort of, I have friends running gaming companies who are sort of charging, and people are paying $300, $400. Right, the APUs, I mean, on the higher side can go even higher. In Supercell Clash of Clans, according to some of the data that I got, the people in India are spending huge amounts of money into that game, but right. it's not at a very common level.
Sure.
And I mean, it might be digressing from your question, but somewhere this hit and miss business, the gaming part is that sort of if you're consistent and if you persist, and if you look at your consumers, keep improving your app, Spice Labs has succeeded by doing that, and I mean,
excellent.
You're able to run that business as a cash business. That's true. The challenge for us is now sort of, and the reason I'm sitting in this VC thing is because now I'm trying to figure out how that scale happens. How can we get to a larger level? If you just want to run it as a cash business, and if you're ready to crunch your numbers, focus on the right segment, do the right bit consistently, it's a good cash business. Those margins actually flow in, and you can sort of just work your way through.
So we have one last question, someone. Yes, please.
Well, in the discussion you said that Indians are not much into gaming. But I find every second youngster or teenager I talk to, they are very much into gaming.
Yes.
At least in their college life and in their school life. But the games that they play are not the games from India. The games that they play are from US or other countries. So the problem I see is not with the gaming culture in India, that is already there. The problem I see is with the good games not coming from India.
So actually there's a way to look at it, right? If you look at the numbers, I mean, internet, you might claim anything, but Comscore still stores 40, 50 million unique. And the global internet is 1.5 billion. Even if you put 100 million as some people claim. So internet, mobile, I mean, if you look at the total smartphones in India, assume every smartphone is owned by an Indian youngster, and every youngster is playing a game, is still minuscule compared to the... So the people around us are not what makes India. That's unfortunately the reality. I mean, the US have 250 million smartphones now, and they all game. The challenge is not youngsters, you know. The puzzle games are played by what we call white women 45. Farmville was played by housewives in the Midwest. You know, all the racing and car games are played by men who've grown up on console. So at least in cultures like that, everybody is gaming. It's like, let me end by the Cadbury problem, right? They spent 20 years trying to convince you that kuch meetha ho jaye means chocolate is not for young kids. And now they're succeeding. So I think that entire categorization of gaming has to get broader to really make it, you know, we should be watching, like we all watch Ramayan, we should be watching playing games. That's when you'll see a Bollywood happening. I think I'm done. Thank you guys. Thank you so much for, you know, tolerating me and, you know, being humored by
thanks.
Thank you, audience, and you know, I hope you guys got something out.